In this lecture, we're going to understand some details about hard disks and how that will help the operating system in making certain decisions. So the hard disk or any storage medium usually provides the interface of blocks, right? So it provides a series of 512 blocks is the common size of the blocks. These are also called sectors. And the disk operates in terms of reading and writing these blocks atomically. That is, you cannot write or read a part of a block. You must either read or write a full block or a sector to the disk. And internally, so this is the interface, but internally the hard disk consists of one or more platters, right? There can be multiple of these platters which are all connected by a spindle, and the spindle rotates at a very high speed, right? And on each platter you have a series of tracks, and each track has sectors, right? And then you have a disk head with an arm that moves along the tracks and over the sectors, right? So there are multiple tracks and each track has multiple sectors, and this disk head moves over the tracks, and as the disk rotates, the disk head will cover all the sectors, right? So this is a high level overview of the geometry of the disk. So what happens when a disk is accessing sectors? So usually the disk gets a series of requests, you know, read the sector, write to the sector, read, write, and so on. And the disk head keeps moving from sector to sector. So suppose your disk head is at sector 30 now and you want to go to sector 11, right? What happens? First thing that will happen is this disk is, of course, always rotating in this direction. And as the disk is rotating, the first thing happens is that the disk head does a seek, that is, it moves. So your sector 30 is on this track, whereas sector 11 is on this track. Therefore, the disk head does a seek. It moves from one track to the other. That is called seeking. And once the seek has finished, it waits for the sector 11 to come under the disk head, right? So there's a seek delay, there's a time to seek, and there's a time to wait for the rotation, right? So the time taken for an IO operation, for a read or write operation, consists of multiple components. There is a seek time, time to move the disk head along the multiple tracks, and there's the rotational latency, the time to wait for the disk to come to the correct sector on that track. And finally, once the disk has reached a certain sector that you desire, there's a time to actually transfer data to or from the disk. So usually amongst all of these three components, the seek time and the rotational latency are few milliseconds, you know, 2, 4, 5 milliseconds. These form the bulk of the overhead. And once you are at the right sector, transferring data actually takes very little amount of time, maybe few tens of microseconds. So given this, usually it is much faster to transfer data sequentially from a disk rather than randomly. Because if you're constantly jumping around sectors, you're wasting a lot of time in the seek time and rotational latency, and very little time actually transferring data. Therefore, if you look at the performance of, you know, say two different types of disks. So for example, compare these two numbers. If you do random IO, you can only read less than 1 megabyte per second. On the other hand, if you're doing sequential IO, if you go to a certain sector, you seek, rotate, go to a sector, and you read a large number of sectors contiguously, then you can get a much higher bandwidth from the disk, right? So in general, all disks try to maximize the sequential access. Operating systems also perform various optimizations to maximize sequential access. So one such optimization is what is called disk scheduling. So when a disk gets requests on different sectors, right? One here, one there, and so on. All these requests need not be served in a first come, first served order, right? So what the disk does, or what the operating system does, is they reshuffle the requests. So that once you've served a request, you decide which of the pending requests you have to serve next in order to read these blocks in order to access blocks in a sequential manner as far as possible. So if you are at a certain block and you know there's a request for the write for the next block, you might want to serve that instead of jumping to the other side of the disk to serve some other request, right? And who does the scheduling? Usually the operating system does not know enough about the location of sectors on the disk. So for the most part, this is done by a small CPU that's present on the disk, which is called the disk controller, right? And there are several different scheduling algorithms that we're going to study, but the main motivation should be clear, which is to access disks in a sequence with as little seek time and rotational latency as possible in order to maximize disk performance. So the simplest scheduling algorithm is what is called the shortest seek time first. So for example, if your disk head is at sector 30 and you have two pending requests for 21, which is on the next track, and sector 2, which is two tracks away, then what this algorithm does is it will go to the track closest to the current track, right? So you will seek to this track and do 21 before you seek to the outer track and access sector 2, right? So this is this algorithm amongst all the pending requests picks the request that has the shortest seek time to serve next. Of course, the problem with this is starvation, right? So suppose you are at the inner track and a whole bunch of requests appear on the inner track, then you're going to constantly keep serving these inner requests and you'll never serve some request on the outer track. Why? Because you're always trying to go to the shortest seek time, go to the request that is close, that's close, that's close. So if a whole bunch of requests appear here, some requests that are far away from the current position of the head may never get served. So a better algorithm and a more commonly used algorithm is what is called the elevator algorithm or the scan algorithm, right? There are several variants of it that we'll see. So what does this algorithm do? You have these whole bunch of sectors. What this algorithm does is it will make a sweep. It will go from the outer track to the inner track. And then it will go back from the inner track to the outer track. And then it will go again from the outer track to the inner track. It keeps sweeping across all the tracks. And any pending requests that are along the path, it will serve them. And then once again, once it reaches one end of the tracks, it will go back again, serve whatever other requests are there along that path. And it will keep scanning back and forth, right? This way, there is no starvation. You're not always stuck in one part of the disk. You are making progress through all the tracks. The certain variants of it, the C-scan or the circular scan algorithm basically goes from outer to inner once and comes back again to outer to inner. It does not go back and forth. It only moves in one direction. And why is that? If you're going back and forth, the tracks in the middle are getting a lot of extra time, right? But the circular scan, it goes from outer to inner or inner to outer and then does the same direction again so that the middle tracks are not getting an extra favor. Similarly, another variant is the F scan. What it does is it freezes the queue. It does not accept any more new requests while it is scanning because the new requests can come in and bypass some of the other older requests. So in order to avoid some starvation and for some fairness reasons, the F scan freezes the queue. So these are all variants, but the high level idea of this elevator algorithm is go back and forth across all tracks and serve requests that come along the path. And of course, both these algorithms are just looking at the seek time. They're not looking at the rotational latency. So another algorithm called the shortest positioning time first, it considers both. So suppose your disk head is at 30 and you have the option of serving request 8 or request 16. Now request 16 is technically has a lower seek time. It's just one track away. But once you seek here, the disk takes a long time before. So this request 16 has a huge rotational latency, right? Before it can come under the disk head, even though the seek time is lower. Whereas sector 8 has a much smaller rotational latency, even though the seek time is longer. Therefore, so this algorithm does a computation over both rotational latency and seek time and decides whichever sector I can get to fastest, considering both seek time and rotational latency, I'll serve that next. Right? So these are all the different flavors of scheduling algorithms. partly implemented by the operating system, but mostly by the disk controller. And one final word about how data is stored on the disk. So in a sector, you store a whole bunch of bits, and these bits can get flipped due to random errors. Therefore, usually along with the data bits, along with the 512 bytes, most modern disks also store a few extra bits. For example, you might store a checksum in order to detect any sort of corruption of disk data. You might also store, along with these 512 bits, you might also store a few extra parity bits so that you can correct any bit errors. Even if some bits here are errored, you can fix them by using an error correcting code. Right? So this extra overhead bits are also stored on the disk in order to account for the fact that, you know, all storage media have errors from time to time. And also the disk controller and the operating system can also handle some such errors. For example, if a sector has gone bad, there's some problem, the bits are getting flipped, then you can blacklist that sector, not access it, and so on. But sometimes, in spite of all of these correction measures, users still do perceive hard disk failure. Some sectors go bad, some files can't be accessed, and so on. So in order to avoid such issues, there are also newer technologies like RAID, a redundant array of inexpensive disks, and things like that, which basically use some sort of replication in order to store the disk data over multiple disks, so that even if one fails, you can provide high reliability and also high performance. So there are several techniques to build reliable and fast storage disks.